Nowadays, global overpopulation is a problem in growth that causes an increase in food demand. And the more time it passes, the harder it gets to meet. Thus, it is estimated that by 2050, a food increase of 50% worldwide and 70% in developed countries will be necessary. Additionally, this problem is aggravated by climate change, soil fertility decline, plague outbreak, and a lack of well-built structural resources, creating significant agricultural losses.
In addition, pesticide overuse to face crops losses is alarming. Most of these products are red-labeled agrochemicals that are dangerous for the ecosystem, human health, and forbidden by law. However, farmers still acquire these products due to the lack of effective alternatives. Taking into account these points, our team, iGen1, decided to take action and provide an alternative to pest control in one of the most iconic national crops. In Mexico, the nopal is an essential resource in gastronomy and biodiversity. This native cactus has inspired the creation of novel products such as biofuels, artificial leather, and food supplements. Furthermore, the farming of nopal generates $165 million per year and more than 12,000 jobs in each rural community it is cultivated, being an economic pillar in the national economy and nopal producer families. However, these benefits are threatened by constant pest attacks. Thus, Milpa Alta, a community that obtains most of its income from nopal production and generates $29 million annually, relies on hazardous and forbidding pesticides to secure their production.
Our journey starts with a visit to the nopal fields in Milpa Alta, a community in the south of Mexico City. They help us understand their problem completely. The first contact was through semi-structured interviews with small producers in a local market where activities start at 2 a.m. As a result of this experience, we discovered that the principal damaging causes in nopal crops are harsh climate conditions, pests, and collateral effects of pesticides.
This engagement changed our vision about the needs of nopal farmers. At first, due to the bibliographical research, we used to think that the main affection was the cochineal insect. However, they told us about the nopal webule. This insect can destroy massively and in every growing stage of the nopal. Furthermore, its mechanical remotion takes many hours and can be ineffective.
On a second visit, we had the opportunity to meet the owner of the local business, El Milpaltense. He gave us the perspective of how our project could fit in intensive agriculture, where production is maximized and the use of mechanical remotion of nopal webule is replaced by pesticides. These activities were fundamental to focus our project against the prejudicial beetle, causing impacts in these families where its income comes mainly from nopal production.
This is where our project begins. Based on our research, talks with experts and consultancies with farmers, Spiticide was born. It is a biopesticide created with synthetic biology, bioinformatic tools, and a local perspective. Spiticide will be an alternative in the management of the cactus weevil in Milpa Alta. The success of a Spiticide is based on two spider venom peptides that act as active ingredients. These peptides have notable characteristics such as being specific to insects, ecological, and also non-harmful for vertebrates. But how did we achieve it?
We started with extensive research for insecticidal peptides and selected about 10 different spider venom peptides that could be useful. Then we proceed to the filtration of these options by considering their toxicity, specificity, and safeness on vertebrates.
Once we finished the selection process, we decided to build our biopesticide with the U1 therapotoxin SP1A and omega exatoxin HB2A peptides from the Australian tarantula and the spider Selenotypus plumips and Hadronychia bursuta, respectively. These selected peptides have a disulfide-rich zone in their structure, which allows them to interact with the voltage-sensing domain 2 from the voltage-gated sodium and calcium channels in the insect's central nervous system. This interaction modifies the pore in the ion channels, disrupting its function, causing the paralysis and death of the insect.
We had to consider that our biopesticide would be mainly consumed by oral ingestion, unlike how it is directly injected by the spider to their target in nature. Thus, once we knew which peptides to use, we needed to find an efficient transport and protection mechanism.
This can be solved with a fusion protein between the selected peptides and the lectin from the plant Galanthus nivalis agglutinin. The lectin allows the absorption of nutrients through the digestive system of the insect, providing a better efficiency to our biopesticide. A 3-alanine linker was used to create the fusion proteins by connecting the C-terminal from each insecticidal peptide with the N-terminal from the lectin. As we wanted to observe the activity of these proteins on the ion channels of insects, prove their inactivity on the ones from humans, and prove their unaffected toxicity as fusion proteins, we did a docking analysis via the web servers HDoc and CluesPro. We used each fusion protein and the sodium channel from the American cockroach Periplaneta americana, which has a 55.76% homology with one from the Coleoptera insect Trivolium castaneum. It is shown in the dockings how both proteins only interact on the voltage sensing domain 2, from the sodium channel of the insect where they have the most potent toxicity, just as described in literature. Meanwhile, the dockings with vertebrate sodium channel show how both proteins do not interact with the voltage sensing domain and thus providing spidicide to be safe in humans.
These docking analyses were possible using the proper tools, such as the specialized software Chimera and Discovery Studio.
Pichia pastoris was the selected expression system to execute our genetic circuits containing the exatoxin and therapotoxin spider venom peptide sequences. As a gist, Pichia pastoris is a single-cell microorganism and therefore relatively fast-growing and inexpensive to maintain. In addition, yeast have the same intracellular environment and similar post-translational modification as higher eukaryotes. Thus, these peptides are more likely to be correctly processed, folded, and assembled. Also, this metallotrophic yeast has the advantage of growing at ultra-high cell densities and the potential to secrete these proteins to the medium, making easier product purification. Pich Zeta Alpha A was the chosen expression vector. It is widely used in Pichia pastoris, and it targets the locus AOX1 in the yeast genome to integrate the plasmid, maximizing the stability of our strain. Two strategies were designed for protein production. In the first option, both peptides are produced in different cells and thus in different bioreactors, allowing a controlled formulation of both peptides in spidicide. The synthesis of this fusion protein is regulated by the promoter AOX1. This promoter is glycerol repressible and methanol inducible. At the same time, GFP is co-expressed to obtain data for the mathematical model and to identify the overproducing colonies. With this design, we achieve genetic circuits that behave as AND gates that allow production when no glycerol is in the media and when methanol is in the media. In this design, we added an histidine tag and a MYC tag for purification and quantification. Also, an XA factor will help us delete the histidine tag in case it interferes with the action of the peptides. Two restriction enzyme coding sequences were added to ensure the circuit modularity. They will allow the exchange of the venom sequences. To assemble the genetic circuit in silico, we used the bioinformatic tool BenchLink. We also proposed the lab protocols for the in vivo assembly using the Gibson technique. To ensure bioengineering excellence, we optimized every genetic part and illegal restriction sites were deleted, following the IGEM standards. In the second option, the benefits of producing both proteins in the same cell were considered, such as obtaining a mixture and using only one bioreactor. For this, we used the yeast Pichia pastoris promoter, PADH1, that regulates the expression of the exatecin fusion protein. This promoter is induced by ethanol and repressed by methanol and glucose. Meanwhile, the teraptoxin fusion protein is regulated by PAOX1. This promoter is induced by methanol and repressed by ethanol and glucose. By using these two mutually exclusive promoters, they behave as three inputs and gates, in which, by changing the carbon source, we can avoid a metabolic overload by synthesizing one protein at a time.
Proposing a mathematical model is fundamental in any aging project. In ours, the model allows us to predict the dynamics of the design circuit and thus optimize the production process at a higher scale level. To achieve this, we design a deterministic model based on ODE system. This model represents the interaction mechanism between the circuit elements, inducer, and our biopesticide over time. The differential equation expresses the inputs and outputs of the system, following known models such as the law of mass action and Hall equation. Usually, the parameters of each component can be obtained from literature experimentally or, as in our case, using the information of similar systems to implement an approach that other IGM teams used time ago. Using the specialist software MATLAB, we made a sensitive analysis of the parameters that have more influence in the variable response of the system. In other words, the production of the fusion protein. The results allow us to prioritize the parameters that will need to be experimentally measured of our system to improve the mathematical model in a second iteration, which will help us tune up simulation and predictions made in silico on the yields in the production of the insecticide.
There are diverse local biosecurity, biosafety, and ethical standards that a project has to meet. In Mexico, there is a law called Ley de Bioseguridad para Organismos Genéticamente Modificados, which regulates any biotechnological activity inside the country. Though this is still a brilliant law, it has not been wide enough to consider all the essential regulations that synthetic biology should have. Therefore, we wrote a guidebook to have a good bioethical, biosafe, and biosecurity practices. This guidebook offers a compilation of national and international laws and regulations surrounding synthetic biology and the creation of our biopesticide. The protocols in this guidebook are split into the three phases. The first phase identifies biological risk and proper chemical handlings. The second phase analyzes how the biopesticide should be stored and managed. Next, the proper disposal of the biopesticide leftover was defined. Finally, the third and the last phase, we designed a proof of concept protocol. As an extra effort to improve the biosafety and biosecurity, we collaborated with Olin Synbio, Tec Puebla, and Miquete teams to create an evaluation tool. The evaluation tool was assembled with at least one bioethic and biosafety expert per each IGM team, and work together to evaluate and provide feedback on each team bioethical, biosafety, and biosecurity integration in their respective projects.
At IGM-1, we know that there is much more in an IGM project than the implementation of synthetic biology. IGM is also a space for collaboration, creativity, sharing science, and quality content with our communities and followers on different media. In a human practices activity, we use a conversation tool to engage with a multidisciplinary group to learn how different profiles thought about synthetic biology. In this, we wanted to encourage an open dialogue around five controversial statements previously defined by us.
By the end of this event, we had a fair amount of opinions that could tell us the society fears around these technologies. Additionally, valuable feedback on how to better approach and plan our future educational activities and our project.
We are very excited to share with you our educational efforts from this season. Besides creating content for our social media, we worked in many science activities, such as two virtual editions of the Congress entitled Revolucionando la Ciencia a Conciencia, whose objective was to present the work of many researchers in our country. Another project that allowed us to meet our educational goals
was the Pijamada Científica. It was a virtual activity organized in collaboration with two IGM Design League teams, Biotech CCM and Firelighters, aimed at high school students. This event consists of a virtual meeting where activities such as conference, talks, discussion panels, experiments, and games took place. The Pijamada Científica was born to share science from our point of view to younger people, to encourage them to study college and understand how important is science for Mexico and Latin America. All these projects aim to fight against the principal academic problems in our country, the academic dropout and the unqualified professional preparation of students. But that was not all. During this season and the pre-season, we joined with the IGM teams, Bolivia, Ecuador, and FSB UANL to organize and perform the workshop and tournament Taller y Torneo de Debate Hispano 2021, as well as the collaboration with FSB UANL at the creation of scientific teaching material for kids entitled Storybook para Niños. Have you ever wondered what is the sound of yellow color or the sound of red or white color? Well, for the painter abstract artist Wassily Kandinsky, the white color represents opposing music. The light blue color was the sound of a flute, and black was culmination, the total silence. For Kandinsky, color and shapes in painting were seemingly like music. This concept is called programmatic music, which uses music to express more than sounds. It aims to depict landscapes, scenes, or paintings. Inspired by this artistic concept, a new project named What is the Sound of the Spidey Side was born. This project has one main goal, to represent in a musical form the structural of the spidey side peptide, omega hexatoxin HB2A. Thanks to the guide of two experts' composition, we managed to create a musical composition written in three movements. The first movement is inspired by the amino acid sequence of the peptide, in which each amino acid is represented by a different musical chord. The second movement simulates how the hydrogen bonds give place to the peptide folding, alpha helices and beta sheets. At last, the third movement represents the most complex structure of the single-chain peptide. It considers how these scaffold bonds provide better stability and biological activity to the peptide. By playing three movements, we can express the different levels of complexity in a protein, going from the simple linear amino acid sequence to the complex three-dimensional structure of a functional protein. So as the protein grows up, the music increases with it. This art project was a particular change, as the team was multidisciplinary, so biologists, designers, engineers, and musicians had to give an extra effort to learn new abilities little used in their respective majors, and work together to create this piece of art. It was a new and unexpected experience, but also a meaningful one for everybody in the team. As Nicole Lugier said, as art and science meet, both break, and in disruptor, they find something new.